responsible, measured and fair. This was the promise from Treasurer Joe Hockey as he prepared to deliver the 2015-16 federal budget. After last year's budget bloodbath, the coalition was hoping for a better reception than 12 months ago. As expected, there were few surprises, lots of talk about the deficit, a boost for small business and a plan to develop Northern Australia. NITV's Myles Morgan spent the day locked inside Parliament House looking over the details of this year's budget and joins us now. And Myles, after the shock of last year, there really wasn't a lot in this budget for Indigenous Australia.
Well, Nat, it's a good word, the budget bloodbath. Let's put it all into context. In 2014, we saw the unveiling of the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, which was the government's actions, which saw over $500 million cut from the Indigenous affairs sector. Now, the IAS caused a lot of confusion and uncertainty. It still is to this day. And that brings us to 2015. And we see that the government did all the hard yards, it would say, last year with the unveiling of the strategy. So this year, there were really no surprises. So let's see if we can bring up some graphics now of what we did see in this year's budget. And we saw a move towards strengthening remote Indigenous communities, specifically in the Northern Territory. About $100 million spent there on stronger futures in the Northern Territory. Also, a new national partnership agreement on remote Indigenous housing to the tune of about $300 million. Back to the Northern Territory, there is a new national partnership agreement which will replace Stronger Futures. So it's the government giving more responsibility to the Northern Territory, which the Northern Territory has obviously wanted for a while now. So it's basically a reallocation of about $1 billion in funding for the Northern Territory and replacing that Stronger Futures legislation. Also, the government has made clear its priority in trying to transition funding to service remote Aboriginal communities to the states, and we've seen a continuation of that in this year's budget. Obviously, we know Western Australia got a $90 million one-off payment to service its remote Aboriginal communities, which obviously started a very controversial spat between the West Australian government and many remote Indigenous communities and Indigenous organisations. Also, money handed out to Victoria, South Australia and Tasmania, about $10 million each, so they could take over servicing of their remote communities. And also a very big one-off payment to the Northern Territory, over $150 million, so that it could take over servicing and providing essential municipal services to its remote communities. Again, something the Northern Territory has wanted for a long time. It didn't really appreciate it being in Commonwealth hands because it believed it was best placed to handle those things. And there have been winners, obviously. We do talk a lot about the Indigenous Advancement Strategy and how much it hurt Indigenous groups last year, but we have seen a few, I guess what you'd call, Nat, budget sweeteners in 2015. IATSIS got an extra $5 million in funding. IATSIS is the cultural institution here in Canberra. Also, the government plans to spend about $5 million this year on getting Indigenous children into boarding schools, elite private schools, closer to the main centres in Australia. And also, income management will be extended in all of its current locations for 2 years by the government. So why does the government hand out these sweeteners? Well, really, it's reflecting their priorities. We know well what Tony Abbott's priorities are when it comes to Indigenous people, getting the Indigenous children to school, getting the adults into work, and making sure those communities are safe. So we're seeing some reallocation of funding and some very gentle funding boost to community organisations, which will reflect on those government priorities. Now, the Treasurer, Joe Hockey, it is his night. Budget night is his night. He did unveil the budget only a few hours ago. Let's listen to what he had to say when unveiling the budget.
Australia's budget position is getting stronger each and every year. From a $48 billion deficit we inherited to $35 billion next year, down to a $7 billion deficit in another 3 years' time. And over the same period, we are reducing the size of government as a share of the economy. Of course, there's more work to be done, more work to be done on budget repair. Every nation must live within its means, and Australia is no different. But we cannot tax our way to prosperity, and we must continue to look for sensible savings. When we invest taxpayers' money, we must do so with great care. It's your money. It's your money that we're spending, and we have to be careful with every single dollar that you contribute. Despite the iron ore price having halved, we are still on a clear and credible path back to surplus, and gross debt in a decade will be over $110 billion lower than that which we inherited.
That was the Treasurer Joe Hockey unveiling the budget here at Parliament House in Canberra tonight. Now, we have seen a bit of a spat between the Commonwealth Government over the last few months, basically since November really. The Commonwealth Government did make a one-off payment of nearly $100 million to the West Australian Government. Basically, that one-off payment was a bit of goodbye money. The Commonwealth gave that to WA so that WA could take over servicing remote Aboriginal communities. And that caused a lot of current controversy, and it still is today, because WA has flagged closing down at least some of those communities because it says they aren't sustainable and it simply cannot afford to fund communities with so few Aboriginal people living in them. But really the federal government's focus with Western Australia has been on something different. We're going to go back to the Treasurer again. Here's what he had to say.
In relation to Western Australia, when the iron ore price was looking at $35 a tonne, or it was falling dramatically and got down to $43 a tonne, there were obviously variations in the estimates of where Western Australia's budget would be at. I have said previously, I don't think it's good for the Federation for one state, and we have to explain it, that we're all Australians, to explain to one state that you're only getting 30 cents back in the dollar of every GST and tax you pay to individuals in Western Australia. Now, we've addressed the issue in the immediate moment, and the Prime Minister has put it on the table for a discussion with the Premiers.
Thank you. That was Myles Morgan reporting there from Canberra, and we will return to Canberra and Myles in just a moment. But first, the response from many First Nations organisations across the country is that the damage has already been done. Peak organisations are insisting the federal government's cuts of over $500 million from its first budget last year should be completely reversed.
We have seen the reversal of decisions around the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Legal Services and Aboriginal Family Violence Prevention Services. So it's good that governments listen to the outcry about those decisions that shouldn't have been made in the first place. But there's still a lot of missing dollars there that are very hard to track down. There's some $270 million in Aboriginal health that we don't know what's happened to that was cut from last year. So we'll be looking for that to be refunded. National Congress of Australia's First Peoples is still defunded. And so that national representative voice is no longer there. So we'll be looking closely at what comes out of the budget, but it is a very difficult process to get to the bottom of where the Indigenous Advancement Strategy and where the budget cuts have landed.
It's hit a lot of communities very hard, and also it's taken away the funding base for the national representative body for Congress. And that is pretty much like taking the heart out of, I think, the ability of our peoples to operate collectively throughout the nation. So it's very, very damaging. Well, those cuts were supposed to be efficiency savings, but we haven't seen any evidence of the efficiency savings, and we think that those cuts should be restored, that if our communities continue to operate with less, $500 million less than what they have received in the past, we will only get poor services and communities having further difficulties.
And Congress and ANTAR are just two of the Aboriginal organisations gathered tonight in Canberra for the federal budget. Many other Indigenous organisations have told NITV News they can't speak publicly on the budget for fear of further cuts to their own organisations. But NITV can reveal that in the lead up to tonight's budget, the government was quietly restoring millions in cuts it had made to frontline Indigenous organisations.
Last year's budget left hundreds of organisations reeling from $500 million in cuts to Indigenous spending. Everything from legal services to domestic violence programs were hit under the incoming coalition government.
It's no surprise that more than 90% of our clients are Aboriginal women and children. This budget brings about uncertainty about our existence and the safety of Aboriginal women and children. This is unacceptable. We have an epidemic on our hands.
The government announced the streamlining of all existing funding into a new single program called the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, with many organisations losing out as a result. But it was the frontline youth and health services targeting drugs and alcohol in communities that were hit particularly hard, something the government denied would happen.
I don't think there'll be job losses, not in terms of our program delivery, not. No, there may be some within the department, but that's another matter, that's a matter for the department. I don't expect any impact on frontline services.
Bernard Dwyer from Amity, which works with Indigenous youth struggling with drug and alcohol addiction in the Northern Territory, said his and other organisations had been preparing to lose services and make staff redundant as a result of the cuts.
Our funding became quite uncertain. Initially, we were told we weren't successful with the Indigenous Advancement Strategy funding, where we understood we had to apply for funding if we were to continue these funded services, which meant that it brought in quite a lot of uncertainty to our client group, our staff, and also our ability to plan into the future.
But in recent weeks, a number of Indigenous organisations, which were told after last year's budget they would not receive funding under the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, have told NITV they have received letters informing them their funding would now be continued, after almost a year of uncertainty for staff and clients depending on their services.
Federal Department of Health that alcohol and other drug services were going to continue to be funded, and so we received a letter indicating that some weeks ago, and we're still waiting for it. It indicated that an officer from the department would be in contact with us to discuss the programs and the funding.
A spokeswoman for the Federal Department of Health told NITV the funding had nothing to do with the previous cuts made under the IAS.
Any funding provided by the Department of Health is completely unrelated to Prime Minister and Cabinet's Indigenous Advancement Strategy.
But organisations contacted by NITV News challenged this, saying the funding they were being offered appeared identical to what they had previously received through the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet, which manages Indigenous Affairs and the IAS.
It appears to us to be a continuation of the existing funding. So it took the focus off probably service delivery and started focusing it on winding down and what we were going to do. So it was quite a distraction initially.
The Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet declined to comment, referring our questions back to the Department of Health. The chopping and changing around funding commitments by the government has created confusion and uncertainty for many Indigenous organisations, which told NITV News they are now awaiting tonight's budget with apprehension. Robert Burton Bradley, NITV News.
Myles Morgan joins us again from Canberra. He's with the Shadow Minister for Indigenous Affairs, Shane Newman.
So it's a very cold and windy Canberra at the moment, but we're going to go now to Labor's Indigenous Affairs spokesman, Shane Newman. And Shane, thank you for making time for us tonight. What's your first response to the 2015 budget?
Well, it's not a budget about people's jobs. It's about a budget about Joe Hockey's job and a budget about Tony Abbott's job. It's not about fairness. It's not about the future. Unemployment will go up. The debt will go up. And the cuts continue, and the cuts continue in Indigenous Affairs. Don't forget, in the last budget, they cut $534 million in cuts. According to that budget last year, there's $145.6 million in cuts, including $46 million in cuts to Indigenous health. That continues in this budget, and the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, the shambles it is, continues to be a shambles in this budget.
And it is still causing confusion, we know that. But there has been a bit more investment in the Indigenous Advancement Strategy this year, in improving internet literacy for Indigenous people, and also in locking in indexation, I believe, for that Indigenous Advancement Strategy funding. So there is that continued investment. Isn't that a good sign?
Oh, $4.8 million. I'm sure people will appreciate that in the context of $534 million in cuts. But there are organisations around the country tonight wondering what's happened to my funding, what's happened to our funding. You know, we're delivering vital services in our community, well, we're going to have to close down and people are going to lose their jobs. This is not a budget about jobs for Indigenous people. It's not about jobs for community control organisations. It's about Joe Hockey's job and it's about Tony Abbott's job. It's not about fairness. And it's a budget that is short-sighted and actually is about increasing taxes. There's 17 new taxes here, including fringe benefit tax increases. And we're seeing a government that's a big spending government, and their expenditure is about nearly 26% of GDP. It's enormous in the context of what they've been saying in the past. This is about a government that's tracked what they said last year, but in terms of Indigenous affairs, the cuts continue.
Shane Newman, thank you very much for your time.
Pleasure.
That was Shane Newman there, Labor's Indigenous Affairs spokesman. Labor has obviously been very vocal about the impacts of the Indigenous Advancement Strategy, the confusion it's caused for Indigenous organisations. Well, we're now going to go to the Greens Party, and the Greens spokeswoman on Indigenous Affairs is West Australian Senator Rachel Seward. Senator, thank you so much for your time and making time for us on this cold Canberra night. Yeah. First response to the budget, you've only had about an hour and a bit to look at it. What's your first response in how it affects Indigenous people?
Extremely disappointed that the government hasn't acknowledged the failure that the Indigenous Advancement Strategy has been and reinvested the money they took out. Clearly, it's having a devastating impact. Chaos is not too strong a word to say reigns when it comes to the Indigenous Advancement Strategy. They haven't fixed that issue. They haven't reinvested the money they took out of Aboriginal health. That's another major issue. And they've refunded income management, which is a very serious mistake, when their own evaluations show that income management doesn't work.
I'm just going to stop you there because, yes, they did extend that trial by 2 years of income management. What does that mean, an extra 2 years of income management?
Well, you can't say it's a trial. This is income management. And by the way, they've also said they're investing money in starting trialling the healthy welfare card and looking into that. That's an extension of income management. Income management does not work. Their own evaluation shows that. So it means that more people are stuck on the basics card, lacking decision-making control or control over their own decision-making, over their own spending. We know it's failed. It was a trial, an experiment from a while ago. They should put the nail in its coffin and actually start giving people control over their own decision-making.
You did mention the healthy welfare card. The government's spending about $3 million on consultations and an initial trial of that. It's only $3 million and there's no extra money over the forward estimates. Does that show a lack of faith in the concept, or does it show that there's not much money to give to the concept in the first place?
Well, it shows that they're bowing to, giving a nod and a wink to Andrew Forrest's weird ideas about how to help Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, extending income management, which is really what it is, because Andrew Forrest thinks that's the way to go. So they had to do something. They think they had to do something to show a bit of support for Andrew Forrest. It's a serious mistake. It's a waste of money. We should actually be investing it, for example, in addressing the huge mess that the two governments, West Australian government and the federal government, has come to over remote communities. Should actually be reinvesting in remote communities and going back and talking to Western Australia seriously around remote communities. And I'm deeply worried about what's going to happen when they hand off municipal services, for example, to South Australia. They've given a bit more money. They'll eventually hand it off. We need to actually seriously rethink that, because they have created, again, more mess in Aboriginal communities. People are very concerned about their future, and they should have addressed that, taken this opportunity to address those issues.
Senator Seward, a lot to talk about, but we do thank you for your time tonight. Thank you for speaking to us.
Thank you, my pleasure.
That was the Greens Senator Rachel Seward, been involved in Indigenous affairs in her state of Western Australia for a very long time, Nat. So there you go. We have heard from the Labor Party and also the Greens Party on this very cold and windy Canberra budget evening. For now, back to you.
Thank you, Myles. You stay warm there. Still ahead, we'll take a look at the reaction on social media and the schoolgirl who took the Treasurer by surprise on Budget Day. Welcome back to our special coverage of the 2015-16 federal budget. Political correspondent Myles Morgan has spent the day crunching the numbers and is joined in Canberra by the chair of the Indigenous Advisory Council.
Well, joining us now is the Indigenous Advisory Council's Chair, Warren Mundine. He has been appointed by Tony Abbott to help roll out the government's Indigenous Affairs strategy. Mr. Mundine, thank you for your time tonight. You haven't had long to look at the budget. What's your first reaction to 2015?
Look, I think it was a very good budget for Indigenous Australians. You've got a lot of potential, a lot of opportunities coming out of that. And you're looking at the $4.9 billion that's going into the Indigenous Advancement Strategy. You're looking at the procurement policy, if that's implemented properly. Probably about $1.2 billion will be going into Aboriginal communities, creating jobs and in businesses. You're looking at the employment parity stuff. That's going to make a big effort. And then also you're looking at the infrastructure and Northern Australia development, which has, another great opportunity for more jobs to go into Aboriginal communities.
Yeah, and the two politicians we had on before did speak about employment and welfare initiatives, but you just brought up Northern Australia there. The government is going to be investing a lot in Northern Australia. Do you welcome that push? Because there are obviously a lot of Aboriginal people in North Queensland and the Territory. That would probably seem to me to be a good place to start employing Indigenous people.
Look, it's common sense. I've got to be quite honest about it. I was disappointed with the initial reports, especially with the Warren Ince report that came out, and then it sort of, on the end of it, it started talking about Indigenous issues. I think they have to be front and centre in regard to the development of Northern Australia. They're the ones who own the country. They're the ones who own the sea. They're the ones that have, that's their traditional countries. They need to be the ones who get the first benefits out of this whole development scheme. So there's a number of initiatives that aren't necessarily under the Indigenous banner, but it does create opportunities for the development of businesses and employment for Indigenous people.
We've just lost light there, but we will continue.
That's all right. Yeah. I'm not used to being in the dark. It's good.
That's black fellas. Very briefly, last question. Your next meeting with the Prime Minister and the Indigenous Advisory Council, what's the message going to be, very briefly?
Well, the message is a good job, heading in the right direction, need more work.
Thank you very much for that, Warren Mundine.
Thank you.
Warren Mundine is the Chair of the Prime Minister's Indigenous Advisory Council. Well, Nat, that's it from Canberra. The budget has been handed down. Stay tuned to NITV for full coverage tomorrow.
Thank you very much. Myles Morgan there in Canberra. Great work, Myles. Well, the keyboard warriors have been busy through the day, sharing their predictions and reactions to tonight's budget on social media. Andrea Booth from NITV Online has been watching the traffic. And Andrea, there's a lot of scepticism among First Australians.
Our social media community is still reeling from last year's budget announcement that $500 million would be cut from the federal Indigenous Affairs portfolio. Michael Lever on Facebook wrote, "I think the Liberal budget strategy can be summed up as year one, slash and burn. Year two, give them back some lollies. Year three, hey kiddies, it's election vote buying time." While no major cuts have been made this year, there was online outrage over the proposed closures of remote Indigenous communities in Western Australia and South Australia. It was exacerbated by last night's ABC Four Corners program called Remote Hope. Twitter user Karen McPhail Bell wrote, "Unbalanced show last night. What about the positive stories?" Many took to Twitter using the hashtags Four Corners and Remote Hope to voice their concern the episode reinforced the government's view that many communities are not sustainable. Alan Clark wrote on Twitter, "Four Corners says it's an expensive exercise to keep homelands running. Surely Aboriginal people have paid a much higher price historically." Tweeters were fearful that this critical report would give reason to cut budgets and more essential services to remote communities under the federal Indigenous Advancement Strategy. Indigenous X tweeted, "Interesting thought to imply that Four Corners is part of the state program to disempower Aboriginal people." Even though the government has left Indigenous affairs largely untouched this year, our online community is keeping a sceptical view. Some think that this may well be a ploy to get the people on side for the oncoming election. When NITV News announced that the government has reversed funding cuts to some Indigenous organisations on Twitter, the Indigenous Legal Centre replied, "Yes, an election coming."
Thank you very much, Andrea. Well, last year, the best remembered budget image was Treasurer Joe Hockey and Finance Minister Matthias Cormann sharing a cigar. This year, it could well be a schoolgirl selfie. While thousands of cameras greeted the Treasurer this morning, it turned out there was an extra lens that he didn't expect. Just as he was wrapping up with the media, a Hunter Valley High School student stepped up to share the limelight.
Can I please
have a selfie?
Sure.
Yes!
Well, I don't want to feel like Kevin right here. You just got one.
Thank you so much. Good luck with everything
thank
tonight.
You, thank you. It wasn't a setup.
Well, that's all we have for tonight. But don't forget, we love receiving your feedback and news tips, and we'd love to hear your thoughts on the budget. You can check out our Facebook page, follow us on Twitter, or contact us by email. I'm Natalie Ahmat. Good night. I'm going to go to the next one.